Brendan Forrest. I am the marketing manager here at Graco for process technology. I'm here with Dan Percott, our worldwide industrial marketing manager for industrial pumps. Today on the Pumpcast, we're going to be talking about peristaltic pumps, or hose pumps is another name for them. So we're just going to do a quick overview just to prime us for some future conversations that we're going to have. So Dan, what is a peristaltic pump?
Yeah, great question. So we'll start there. In the simplest terms, a peristaltic pump is a type of positive displacement pump that uses a hose, and all it's doing is distributing material. The most common application is metering or dosing. That's specifically what these pumps are designed for.
Okay. So metering and dosing, what specific applications do we usually see those out in the field?
Yeah, so what we're really looking at is anything that needs to be dosed or metered. So when we look at distribution of chemicals for fresh or wastewater specifically, you're going to see these pumps everywhere. You'll see them dosing bleach and chlorine into swimming pools, at water parks, at hotels, you know, anywhere that there's a real, let's call it industrial/commercial size swimming pool. We see them being used for lime slurries, magnesium hydroxide, which are specifically used for odor control in city sewers. Every large municipality in the world has to do something with their storm sewer to mitigate odor. And these things are really working behind the scenes to dose this chemical to keep the odor down. We'll see on the food and beverage side, we do a lot of dosing flavorings, colorant, all of those things that make our food taste and look the way it looks. So that's what we see on the food and bev side of these things. Also, it kind of gets forgotten, but anything that's really abrasive or if there's a high solid content. The idea being that with a peristaltic hose pump, your only true limitation for passing solid is the diameter of the hose. So if it'll fit through the hose, you can basically pass it through the pump.
So you talked about municipal water treatment. Is there any sort of applications in the industrial side in plant?
Yeah. So if we think about it this way, any plant in the United States specifically, but generally the world over, they have to treat the water that is part of their waste process. Now, you can't just pass this into the municipality water treatment system anymore. So generally what you're doing is you are manipulating the pH level before it gets into the city sewer. They can do the further treating from there, get it out into an evaporative pool or pond, but you have to do some pH treatment before it can get to them. That's kind of putting it in the simplest terms, but that's where you start on the industrial side.
Are there any applications on the industrial side where it's in process? So we talked about like adding colorants and dyes into food and beverage. Is there any of those types of applications on the industrial side?
Yeah. So if you're looking at chemical processing, anytime that you have a chemical that needs to be metered at a real highly accurate dose, you're going to be looking at a peristaltic pump because of the nature of how they work. And we can show a quick animation here as well. They do a really good job of slowly dosing through that rotary motion. And they're generally set up to do this over a long period of time. So think that this pump is dosing all day long, 24 hours a day, small amounts to continue to, whether it's a process improvement or whether it's actually injecting a chemical into a process.
What does the action look like inside of the pump, right? So we have the inlet outlet. What's going on inside the pump to get that fluid to move through?
Yeah. So if you look at the animation, what you'll see is you'll see the roller is rotating around. It's going to start, for the sake of this conversation, at 12 o'clock, and it rotates all the way through in this animation in a clockwise fashion. And the beauty part about a peristaltic pump is it's siphoning or suctioning and discharging throughout the whole process. So the hose is being squeezed all the way through 360 degrees. So you're always outputting product as you're bringing product in, and that allows you to really dose accurately.
And then talking about like sizes, you know, what are the typical sizings that we'll see for a peristaltic pump?
So peristaltic pumps are kind of defined in two ways. You have what's called a hose pump and you have what's called a tube pump. Tube pumps are generally used for ultra, ultra low dose. Think in the neighborhood of sub 1 gallon per hour, and in some cases less than 1 gallon of material per day. Hose pumps are generally used more on the industrial side of things. They're going to be a little bit larger. So think 6 millimeter inside diameter up to 30 to 40 millimeter inside diameter with flow rates in sub 10th of a gallon per minute up to, say, 20 gallons per minute.
Okay.
So you're going to have hose sizes again. You'll, from, say, 6 millimeter, then maybe there's a 10 and a 20 and a 25. And because your flow rates are determined by the diameter of that hose, by the volumetric amount of material that can be contained within a hose. Sure.
Okay. So we're looking at a peristaltic in these applications for metering and dosing. Why would we pick a peristaltic over, say, a diaphragm, a rotary lobe, or a centrifugal pump, or any other type of pump technology?
Again, the key here is going to be metering. Most of those pump technologies, diaphragm, rotary lobe, gear pump, centrifugal, they don't dose very well. They're not designed to do that. Those are transfer units. They take the material from one point and they send it to another. This is truly looking at taking from, call it a storage vessel or a tank, and dosing and distributing that over a very, very small amount at a very controlled meter for a significant amount of time. Those pump technologies don't do that very well. Some of those pump technologies, think centrifugal, rotary lobe, gear pump, they don't pass solids and abrasives very well either, because they have seals, they have gears and lobes that don't play well with material that's abrasive. So that's really where a peristaltic pump can shine. And also, it's completely sealless. Your fluid is only coming into contact with the hose and the barbs to connect into your plumbing system. There's no mechanical seals to fail, no gasketing, no any of that material. It makes these pumps really simple to maintain and very, very durable.
And so it's really just based on the life of the hose.
Realistically, that's your only consumable component is a hose, correct?
Okay. So I have an application. I know I need to meter and dose a chemical. I've selected a peristaltic pump. Now, how do I go about building a peristaltic pump for my specific application?
Great question. So when we talk about specifying a peristaltic pump, we're really looking at three things here. We're looking at the material being pumped, because we have to specify the right hose. There's always chemical compatibility considerations. We have to look at the flow rate range that the customer is going to be looking at. When we talk about positive displacement pumps, normally we're talking about a very static flow rate. Think diaphragm or centrifugal. I need 20 gallons per minute and I pick a pump to fit. With peristaltic pumps, because generally you're treating, let's look for an example, the wastewater. A municipality is treating a range of water per day, not a static amount. And that could be based on usage. That could be based on a rain event, something like that. They could be treating anywhere from 1 million to 5 million gallons per day. They need to be able to vary that. And peristaltic pumps allow you to do that, but you have to be careful in specifying a range. Otherwise, you start to need multiple pumps at that point, because generally that range of pumping is very narrow. Think 6-to-1 turn down, because you're limited based upon the electric motor. Okay. So let's use, for example, a peristaltic pump has a low end range of 1 gallon per minute. The high end is really only going to be 6 gallons per minute. If you need something outside that, you need a different pump at that point. Still a peristaltic, but the next size up. If you need less than that 1 gallon, you may need a pump that's smaller than that. So that range is really critical in understanding what you need. Otherwise, you're going to need multiple pumps. And people do make mistakes in regard to that. The third is we need to understand what input voltage they want. When you're talking electric motors, if you've got an end user who wants to run single phase power, whether that's 120 or 240, you can only run up to about 2 horsepower on single phase power. If they need a bigger motor than that, then we need to start talking 3 phase and so on. We want to make sure that we're specifying the right motor for the given voltage for the pump or for the application.
Okay. So when I'm selecting a peristaltic pump manufacturer, what things should I keep in mind when looking at the different brands out there?
Yeah. And there are a lot of them. What we really want to do is, first, you want to pick a manufacturer that obviously has a solid reputation for quality. You want somebody who can support your products long term. There's a lot of products out there, and I don't want to poke at the imports, but there's a lot of imported product where they're continuously changing their pump models and they can't support those anymore. You want to make sure somebody can support you with parts, can support you with technical support and going forward, even application assistance. This is not easy stuff when you talk about applying these pumps. There's a technicality to it that go beyond a centrifugal pump, a diaphragm pump. This is not what I refer to as dumb pump technology. There's some, you need to be able to provide that inherent value to get the pumps applied properly. Otherwise, you're going to end up with, you know, I like to say a 200-pound boat anchor if the pump doesn't do what you need it to do. More than that, honestly, where we're going today, you want to partner with somebody where sustainability is part of their action plan. And I'll use Graco for an example. There's no pump company on the planet that is as vertically integrated as Graco is right now. We take in raw material, we send pumps out on the other end of our factory. The thing about doing the vast majority of your own manufacturing is it allows us to control the quality because we do the machining, we do all of the assembly in one facility, which is in Minneapolis, and it allows us to reduce waste too. We don't make the mistakes that a lot of vendors who are simply machining something for us, they don't have that same focus on quality like we do. It allows us to continuously improve our processes as well. And this increases efficiency at the plant level. And I really think that nowadays, this is really resonating with the end users. They want a high quality product with nearly zero warranty. And this product, our Solotech peristaltic pump, checks all of those boxes.
Okay. So let's talk about the Solotech. Obviously, you know, a Graco product. What makes the Solotech different from other peristaltic pumps on the market?
Yeah, great question. So when you look at peristaltic pumps, you generally have two main designs that are out there. You've got a double shoe design, which is basically two static kind of crescent moon shaped shoes, and they rotate 360 degrees. They're basically scrubbing the hose as they go through the process. And you also have a single roller design, which is what we use. The single roller design is very beneficial because it reduces the friction significantly versus a double shoe design. Number one, it's one contact point. It's rolling versus, as I said, scrubbing the hose. Scrubbing the hose creates a lot of friction, and heat is the end of the hose. I mean, let's be honest. And if you can reduce that friction, whether it's through lubrication or through a better process of squeezing the hose, you're going to be better off and you're going to improve hose life. Graco also uses a very oversized roller in our pumps. I have one here, as a matter of fact. This is from our ST23 pump. This roller is very, very large, comparatively speaking, to what's out on the market. The point of that is that we're getting a full squeeze, a better squeeze than the competition, which again is in turn reducing the friction because we don't have to squeeze as much per revolution to get the same amount of product out of the pump. It's been a great addition to our product line for that reason, and it has dramatically increased hose life. We see versus competition 3 to 5 times hose life over, I don't want to use the term industry leaders, but some of the higher volume pumps that are out there right now.
What does that mean in terms of dollar amount? Right. So 3 to 5 time hose life. Well, what does that actually mean for the end user in terms of cost?
Great question. So if you start looking at something in the neighborhood of a 30 millimeter hose, which is a large hose, you're probably looking at, let's talk list price, depending on the hose material, $800 to $1,000 US to replace a hose. When you're only replacing that twice a year versus 5 times a year, that is significant. And what it allows you to do, number one, I mean, let's face it, what are we trying to do in the pump world, regardless of the manufacturer? We're trying to reduce downtime. So you're reducing downtime by creating a pump that will make the hose last longer. And you're saving them, of course, cost of ownership at that point as well. So it also allows us by reducing the friction with the roller design that we have, you use less lubricant as well, because the friction is reduced to a point where you don't need a lot of lubricant. And lubricant is hazardous waste. When you change a hose, you have to dispose of it. It goes back to that sustainability thing. The less hazardous waste you can throw away, the better off you're going to be. So we're affording our end users that as well.
What with the peristaltic pump, like, what are the things that end users are really concerned about? I'm assuming, like, you know, with municipal water treatment is chlorine, right? So like leaking chlorine is probably not good. Like, so are we able to reduce any of that, or how do we address some of those issues?
So I think the number one thing is when you're able to increase hose life to the degree that we are, you allow them to establish a more accurate preventative maintenance schedule. So when you start leaking chlorine into a peristaltic pump, that can be problematic, obviously. You don't want chlorine to off gas. It's very dangerous in a plant environment. So if you can give them a better hose, a better roller design that increases life across the board, you can start doing those PMs every 6 months instead of every 3 months. And every peristaltic pump at some point is going to experience a hose failure. If you can mitigate that by offering a better solution, that just makes everything better for the end user, the environment, all okay. of the above.
All right. I think that's all the questions I have for you today, Dan. Any other parting thoughts that you have?
Yeah, you know what? I just want to make a comment that when we designed this pump, we released this pump in 2015. This was really an end user, customer focused project. We wanted to give them a better product by significantly increasing the life of the hose. We have done that in a dramatic fashion, and we've given them the opportunity to make a safer plant environment, decrease their costs. There's less waste going into wherever they have to get rid of their hazardous waste from a lubricant perspective. This was really, again, a customer driven project, and we really feel we checked all those boxes.
Awesome. All right, everyone. Well, thanks for listening to the show today. If you have any thoughts or questions on what we talked about today, please drop us a line in the comments of this video, on LinkedIn, or send me an email at process_marketing@greco.com. So like I said, we are active on Greco or on LinkedIn. So connect with us there. I'll drop our handle in the comments. So Dan, thanks for giving us a rundown today. We'll be doing a more in-depth look at peristaltic applications, look at the pump technology, and selecting the right peristaltic pump for you to get your job done. So we're all done today, and we'll catch you next time. Thanks
for having me.